Hey guys, it's Kris Jones for episode 16 of Ask Me Anything. In this episode, we dive into a part two of a two-part series featuring questions by my good friend, fellow entrepreneur, fellow just extraordinary human being, Kris Masters. In the last episode, you know, I kind of just paid respects to him. You know, when I think about, well, actually, when you think about those people in your life that allow you to be who you are, that reaffirm the parts of you that you hold the most amount of respect about, that's Kris Masters. Kris has a way of, you know, acknowledging and admiring those parts of me that I want to bring more out of, if you will. You know, Kris was one of the early supporters of the Ask Me Anything. And, you know, just over all these years, he gets me. And he's been just such an unbelievable person with supporting who I am and, you know, and not questioning that. And I want to thank you, Kris, for that. And let's dive in to your questions. I think those of you that watched episode 15 will agree that Kris has a way of peeling back the onion almost better than anyone before him in terms of asking me these questions. I really, really sincerely appreciate it. So let's dive into it. The first sort of set of questions here are on the topic of patience. So he says, and I love this, I've never quite heard it put this way, he said, building a successful business is not a bag of microwave popcorn. So building a successful business is not a bag of microwave popcorn. You're absolutely right. It takes time to put the right pieces in place, and not all of those pieces will be exciting, new, or fun. What actions or practices do you implement to maintain patience in the process? Or do you break it down into daily bite-sized pieces and make it a lifestyle and a mindset to embrace each step? I mean, holy cow. That's a great question. So this is a business question. So first, I just think through the economics of the opportunity. I tell this story. I was a teenager. I was driving over the Market Street Bridge in Kingston. I literally could have been 15 years old, and there was a hoagie shop that was there. And I thought to myself, you know, from a unit economics point of view, how many hoagies does that store need to sell in order to sell $1 million worth? And so whenever I'm kind of thinking about setting up a new business, I kind of obsess about the unit economics and just the broader economics of the opportunity. In the previous video, I talked a lot about market opportunity, market analysis, and timing. So that's part of it. It's part of my response here. But I even go a little bit deeper. I think it was episode like 6 or 7, I talked about this real simple formula that I have. Find something that works, number one. 2, replicate it. 3, scale it. That whole process is something that I still use to this day in businesses. I have no interest in putting fuel on the fire if I can't get something to work. So it's the testing, the product market fit, all of that stuff up front. I put a lot of time and energy into it. And as I mentioned, I'm looking for opportunities, big opportunities. Since I raise capital a lot, I could tell you that most of the tier A venture capitalists, I'm not suggesting this is my rule to get involved in a new business, but one of their rules is that it needs to be a market big enough that should we be successful, it could be a billion-dollar opportunity. So I'm not suggesting that's my rule, but that's how they think about it. And I've raised venture capital before, so I know what it takes to do that. But in my world, Kris, I'm thinking, you know, is it a big idea with a capital B or a big idea with a smaller case B? You know, I could probably get more excited about a bigger case B. And the other thing is, you know, the risk profile of going into a big market where the economics are on your side. For instance, mobile in the transportation industry. Transportation industry, huge, broken. Uber comes in with a simple yet contemporary, trending in terms of mobile solution, and you know, basically disrupts an entire industry. So the other thing is, right out of the bat, I say to myself, who else out there is doing what I want to do? And I don't mean exactly, because ultimately I'd like to differentiate a little bit, although I don't think that's always required. But I say, you know, is there anyone out there doing what I'm looking to do? And I literally study them. What are you doing that is working? And what are they doing that isn't working? This is for starters. This is before I even, you know, decide on the brand of the company. I'm just kind of thinking through ideas and opportunities here. So often, you know, I will, you know, when I'm building a business, sometimes I'll have the idea for the business before any of that other stuff comes in. I'll already do the market analysis and the competitor analysis and all of that stuff. So once I have a good sense that this could be a winning idea and a winning business model, and that I think even if there's competition doesn't scare me, because it provides us with a roadmap, a blueprint of what's working and what doesn't work. So I'm not one of those people that starts with, you know, the fact that I need to invent, invent something that's going to cure some debilitating disease. That's not how I think. So what I start doing is I start putting in place, once I go through that, those couple of things, I start putting in place those things that I think correlate most strongly with business success. These are the things that I call the sort of 5%. 95% of entrepreneurs, just for a lot of reasons, not for whatever the reason, I know what the reasons are. That's what I study. That's where I add most of my value when I make investments or when I build a business. But 95% of entrepreneurs fail. So I like to play in that 5%, which is, I hope, what you like to play in, not Chris, but others who are watching. That's what part of this video series is all about. So part of that 5% represents my response to the question, which is I start building out my team. So I only have so much bandwidth. So as Warren Buffett says, you know, you hire smart people and you get out of their way. That was definitely part of my success at Pepper Jam, part of my success at Refer Local, part of my success at LSEO, part of my success at Epic Mobile Apps and others, is I just associate myself right from the start, right out of the gate. I don't purport that I'm going to do it all alone. I am getting ready to give other people credit for my success. So I start building my team with a capital T. I also, right out of the gate, put in place financial processes and controls. I talked about that in episode 10 of Ask Me Anything, when I talked about my M&A process, my M&A sort of checklist. It is so critical. The 95%, the ones that fail, get this wrong. They either think about this too late or they are just afraid of numbers. You need to fall in love with numbers. You need to put in place those financial processes and controls right out of the gate. I also begin the process of what I call drinking my own Kool-Aid. So there are certain skills that I have, whether they be growth marketing, raising capital, acquiring talent, and I start putting these things in place right out of the gate. Maybe I don't raise capital right out of the gate, but I start putting feelers out there about my new business in front of people who have the capacity to invest should I need to raise capital. And I think that that's a very important part of the 5%, is that we anticipate, we start to, predict the future, if you will. And that's part of what I do with my Kool-Aid strategy, is that, you know, I certainly don't want to get beat at my own game. I set goals and I test growth strategies. So on the goal setting, we talked about that in a previous episode. I get very specific And I set goals that make me feel a little bit uncomfortable. That's just how I roll, and I think that's how you should roll. But I do that right from the start. Goals are important because they hold us accountable. Goals in the business world are like financial projections. 12 months out, 24 months out, 36 months out. For those of you that are entrepreneurs and don't have financial projections in place, understand something. I have obsessed over the last 17 years with why businesses fail and why they succeed. One of the reasons they succeed is because the entrepreneur, the CEO, the founders, for whatever the reason, you're afraid of numbers, you've got to make love to numbers. You've got to roll around in numbers. You've got to make numbers like your best friend. Numbers have to be like, you've got to get a crush on becoming super, super sensitive and in love with numbers. So right out of the gate, I take that serious, and I make sure that I have all of those processes in place. So the goal setting in terms of the financial projections allows me to do that. And then the growth strategies is really just my three-part test. Find something that works, replicate it, and scale it. And throughout this whole process, Tony Robbins has a formula called the Ultimate Success Formula. You should Google it, print out as much information on it as you can, and study it. But it ultimately comes down to setting a goal, taking action, and then the third part of that is assessing whether or not you're getting closer or further from your intended goal. So I keep an open mind about sort of pivoting or deviating if necessary. I'm not looking to just jump all over the place. I want to give, a pot of coffee, or actually a cup of coffee, it tastes better with hot water than it does cold water. You got to let the water warm up. You got to give it time, but you've got to have an open mind about changing course or correcting course, not changing course, but correcting course to get closer to your goal. If you decide that you're getting further, you got to take action. So those are just some of the tips and some of the sort of, once you peel back the onion, as it relates to why most of my businesses succeed. So your next question is, you say, I have been exploring the notion that there is no true top to the mountain rather than a lifetime of experiences with a number of successes along the way. I feel it is important to recognize and celebrate achievement, but to then hand the ball back to the referee and go score another touchdown. And you asked me for my thoughts. And so, Tony Robbins has this acronym called CANI, C-A-N-I, which is constant and never-ending improvement. Back in my psychology days at Penn State University in Villanova, where I got a master's degree, I learned about this pyramid called Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And anyone listening has probably heard of this. The bottom of the pyramid is the basic necessities of life, food and water and the basic stuff. That's not where we want to spend most of our time, struggling for that stuff. We want to spend most of our time up at the top of the pyramid, which is called self-actualization. So, listen, at the end of the day, you can be the turtle. You could live by the philosophy that slow and steady wins the race. And honest to God, there's nothing wrong with that. For what it's worth, just like a fine wine, it gets better with age. And having a constant and having predictability in one's life is certainly one way of achieving happiness. Because for some people, if you don't have a stomach for it, making a lot of moves throughout your career, or doing what I do, which is have a ton of things going on at any given time, might be painful, might be anxiety provoking. And so the slow and steady thing, that could be a great solution for anyone. As long as, I would suggest that individual has an attitude to constantly and never ending with constant never ending improvement. However, like I said, that's not how I am. And Kris, I know over the course of your career, you know, you've been in so many different roles, and plus, you know, you're a civic person as well, giving a lot of your time to charity and to nonprofit, you know, organizations. But so yeah, I've jumped around a lot, and I think I'm a lot more like a chameleon, you know, and I've gotten a lot of satisfaction out of that. It's almost like it sounds like more of a risk-taking approach. But it's actually, if you think about how, you know, our parents and our grandparents told us to invest our money, they say, diversify, you know, don't put all your eggs in one basket. So in an ironic sense, if some folks looked at your life or my life, because we both have so much going on, they might say, oh my God, these guys are risk-taking. But in reality, we're actually being more conservative by diversifying. You know, I think that it really just depends on where you're at in your life. You know, sometimes doing the slow and steady thing makes a lot of sense, and sometimes jumping all around does. I can tell you, I wasn't anticipating sharing this, but I can tell you as I get older and I just gain a greater sense of appreciation spending quiet time with people I love, my kids, my wife, you, other great friends of mine. You know, I almost do want to slow it down and kind of, you know, getting into the previous episode with your questions around being very careful with where we spend our time and really thinking about this return on time. But again, at my heart, I'm still a young entrepreneur, a young business owner, and so I'm a chameleon. And here's my core belief. My core belief is that as long as I can maintain a positive and optimistic attitude with whatever I'm working on, I'm going to be happy, number one, and number two, I'm going to be successful. So it really just comes down to that. You know, if I could bring that attitude to everything I do, I think that, you know, I'm going to be the type of person that other people want to work with. I'm the type of person that the kids are going to want to come home at night and spend time with them. And I'm the kind of person that will have an unlimited amount of opportunities no matter, you know, no matter what I do. And I think it's important, though, that we hold ourselves to a high standard when it comes to our contribution to the people we love most. So in that way, I do adhere to Abraham Maslow's self-actualization and Tony's constant never-ending improvement as just a way of life. And for me, that means I have a lot of irons on the fire, a lot of things going on, as I know you do as well. So there's one final question here, and it's on tools. You ask me, what tips and tech tools do you use to manage your vast networks of contacts? And so I jotted down a couple of things I use. Here's just what I use. I use my iPhone contact list. Chances are if you make it into that, you know, we have a first level connection. I use LinkedIn. I probably decline, you know, upwards of 50 to 60% of people that, you know, extend a connection to me, partly because I get the sense that they're trying to sell me something and not truly create a first level connection with me. But anyway, so I have some hacks with LinkedIn with regard to how I accept people on there. So if we're connected on LinkedIn, that I consider that a first level connection. I use AngelList. So in my investment world, I have, I don't know how many thousands of followers I have on there, but I may only follow a couple hundred people. And those couple hundred people, so we share the connection, is are people that if they reach out to me. So for instance, if you have, if you follow someone and they follow you back on Angel and they put a syndicate into the Angel network, I get a direct invite into that. So I'll just give you a quick example. Barbara Corcoran from Shark Tank. Her and I are first level connections. And so I get to see all the deals that she puts in there. And I don't have to reach out to Barbara and say, hey, can I be in that deal? Because we're connected one-to-one, I could invest in any of her deals, which is pretty cool to see. And then finally, I have been using Facebook Messenger. So I have two Facebook pages. One is my personal Facebook page, and then the other is sort of the, whatever, they used to call them fan pages, now they're just called business pages. My personal Facebook page, I take very seriously. I have pruned that page for the last couple of years. I've probably turned it over, I don't want to say by 50%, but you know, it's such that if we're connected on Facebook, on the personal side, and you reached out to me, and I'm not suggesting anybody do this, but if you reached out to me and said, hey, Kris, I need you to, you know, help me move some furniture, and you reached out to me via Facebook Messenger, since that's how you communicate, unless it's on your wall, I probably would be over to help you. So anyway, those are my four things, but there's no silver bullet here. I just prune, you know, and I hack the available network management solutions so that it respects my time, and that I know that if you are a first level connection, you know, I'm gonna take the call, I'm gonna spend more time making sure that I evaluate whatever it is that, whatever opportunity that's there. Whereas, since I use those tools, if you're reaching out to me and we're not connected on LinkedIn, we're not connected on AngelList, we're not connected on Facebook, I don't take those outreaches as serious. So now you know how to hackety hack. If you do want to get my attention, you do want to ask me some questions, you know how to do it now. We either need to become Facebook friends or one of those other areas. So in conclusion, I think the last episode in this one got at two ideas that I think impact all of us. Number one is, how do we make decisions as we go through life about where we spend our time, where we spend our energy, and where we can make the greatest contributions of our time and our energy? And I gave you guys my response. I think that's absolutely critical. And then the second piece is, once we make these decisions, right, and we're in the midst of the impact of that decision, how do we think about, you know, correcting course if necessary? Or you don't necessarily always have to correct course, but how do we develop a sensitivity, a level of acuity around seeing bigger opportunities and attracting bigger opportunities into one's life? I hope you guys enjoyed my responses. I want to thank you for tuning in to episode 15 and episode 16, which featured questions from my good blood brother, Kris Masters. I encourage those of you that are still watching right now to post some questions, to share this video series with people who you think it would benefit. Like what you like, give me feedback on what you like and don't like. And ultimately, I ask you to not be passive during this whole process. Be active. Find a way of, you know, one of the things I learned through leadership training is to write down things. You know, keeping a goal in your head or keeping an idea in your head is exactly where it's gonna stay. It's gonna be in the ether. It's gonna just be an idea. You wanna go from idea to action, you have a pen or a pencil and a piece of paper, and you start writing. I would encourage you to do the same thing with this. But I need your active participation in these so that they can ultimately deliver the greatest value back to you possible. I will see you in episode 17. Have a great day.